you so much, all of you, for being here. I'm really excited to do this talk this morning to talk about my favorite subject, money, and of course, being a woman. As a woman, I was in banking and finance for 22 years, so I have experienced a lot of the gender bias, gender discrimination, pay gaps that a lot of women face today. So a little bit about me. As the moderator stated, my name is Sandy. I am the president and founder of Karmic Currency, the energy behind business and finance. I teach a holistic approach to money, understanding the money mindset, and how to clear your blocks in order to be more successful, manifest abundance, and create wealth in your life. My recent passion project, Her Worth Circle, Financial Literacy for Women, is a nonprofit organization and a social impact arm of Karmic Currency, where I bring financial literacy to women of all financial backgrounds and all stages. I am a number one best-selling author, Karmic Currency. I have been featured in Brickle Magazine, Bloomberg News, Miami New Times, and Marie Claire, to name a few. So a little bit about me. I'm often known as the money angel. My clients seek my services consistently because I find money where sometimes money is not to be found. I find creative financing and strategies for my clients, whether it's setting a budget, planning for home ownership, getting out of debt, or repairing your personal or business credit. I'm here to help you every step of the way by taking the anxiety out of money and your financial decisions by incorporating spiritual practices such as yoga, Reiki, theta healing, astrology, and human design. I promise you, nothing that you've heard, nothing that you know about money, you will ever hear, you've heard it here first. So for 22 years, I had and worked in the financial services industries, holding several licenses and certifications. As a former vice president, I actually held $90 million under my portfolio and under my asset management with my team. I was often reprimanded for being a maverick, as you can see today, pioneering a brand new concept and bringing a completely different evolution and thought theory to money and how we see it and how we define the use of it. Back in 2017, I was let go from my high-profile position and I was fired from my job. Let me tell you a little bit about that. So, in 2017, I was recruited from the financial institution that I was working at and went to work at a brand new office where they hired me to grow their portfolio and grow this branch because I had already a reputation for success and I had proven already my tenure in the industry. Against all my better intuition, when I was offered this position, I knew better than to have gone, but I went anyway. And why did I go? Money. They offered me an amazing, amazing salary, more than I had ever made before. They gave me a sign-on bonus, and how could I say no? As a single mom of two children, they made it very, very difficult. Basically, they made me an offer that I couldn't refuse. And so I took the job. Within 2 weeks of being there, I was absolutely miserable, and I knew that I had made the biggest mistake of my entire career. I hated it. It was a boys' club. I was excluded from meetings. I was excluded from decisions. My opinions didn't matter. The things that I needed to say, the ideas that I was bringing to surface, what they had hired me for, was now a moot point. I was no longer a key player. I was no longer valued in that industry or in that space. And in fact, at one moment, the regional vice president took me into his office. And he made this comment, and he goes, well, you know, we just hire people, and, you know, we'll just pay them whatever, and if it doesn't work out, you know, in a few months, we'll just let them go. And that resonated within me for many weeks, and I realized that he was talking about me, and he was already making a comment that I was dispensable, and I could be replaced if I did not follow the rules. Well, little did he know who he was dealing with, because as I mentioned before, I am a maverick and I make my own rules, and that doesn't bid well in corporate America. You need to follow the process, you need to follow the rules, you need to play nice. And I was already a minority, female, Latina, so I already had a lot of things going against me. Within that time that I was there, as I mentioned, I was absolutely miserable, and I started to build my exit strategy. I told myself, I need to stay here at least 12 months so I don't have to pay back my sign-on bonus because I had already used that money to get out of debt, pay off my credit cards, and take care of my finances. So that wasn't an option. And I needed to figure out how I was going to move forward in the next step of my life because at this moment I knew that I no longer wanted to stay in banking. I wanted to do something different and it was now my time. That is how karmic currency was born. I had already received my yoga teacher certification. I had already started practicing in the spiritual spaces and learning about energy, learning about metaphysics, and understanding the dynamics that happens within the human soul and the human spirit. Within that, I started to see the connection and really go back and connect the dots with my clients at the bank. Understanding what their thoughts were, how they wanted to use their money, why some clients would invest, why some clients wouldn't invest, why some people were more conservative with their money, why some people were frivolous with their money. And I started understanding that childhood and our beliefs and what we're taught about money, we learn at a very young age. And that is how I started to write and build out my business. I created my website. I've never designed a website ever in my life. Don't even ask me how I do it. I couldn't even go back in there and do it right now if I wanted to. But I built my website. I ordered my business cards. I created the blog posts. I made the social medias. I mean, I did everything that I needed to do to have this business. And I was ready. And within 6 months of about that, you know, time frame of me building all my business, they called me into the office one day. I get a text from my boss. And he says, hey, come down to the main office tomorrow. I want to talk to you. And I said, okay, sure. You know, no problem. I'll be there. What time? He says, you know, around 9, 9:30. I'm like, okay, cool. I called up my other female counterpart because, you know, we were the minority. It's, like I said, it was a boys club. And I said, hey, Steph. And she says, what's up? I said, I think I'm going to get fired. She's like, what? No, you know, you're not going to get fired. Why are you going to get fired? I go, I have a feeling, man, I'm going to get fired. And she says, but how are your numbers? Are your numbers okay? Are you hitting your quotas? Like, you know, what's happening? And I said, no, everything is fine. And she says, well, why would you get fired? And I said, I have this feeling. Sure enough, get to the office the next day. They let me go. They said, you know, it's not working out. We don't think this is the right fit. I agreed, obviously. And I said, okay. And so I cried because who wants to get fired? And this is what, you know, we do as women. We cry, we get emotional. And I cried, and through my tears, they said, do I have to pay back my sign-on bonus? And they said, no. And I said, okay, bye. And I left, picked up my cliche box, came home. And as I'm in my car driving, you know, I'm of course crying. I'm like, what am I going to do now? I didn't want to go back to the bank. I'm a single mom. You know, now this wasn't my plan. And I literally heard the voice of God, the universe, whatever you want to define your belief as. And he said, it's not your time, it's my time. And I say now. And leave it to me, like I said, who I am as a person, to argue with the voice. And I'm like, no, I'm not ready. This can't be. And he said, you're ready. And that's it. And at that moment, was live in a living color, and I'm happy to say that this month actually makes 5 years that I've been in the entrepreneur space. I have helped over 250 clients find and manifest abundance, understand their relationships with money, and it's a beautiful, beautiful place, and I couldn't be more happy, because as they say, when you follow your passions, you don't work a day in your life, and I haven't worked one day in 5 years. So I would like to share, as we talk about women and money, this really great clip.
In the room, concentrate, focus. Women respond when you respond to them.
My friend Maggie is a really talented designer. Mm-hmm. I've seen the business plan and the samples look fantastic. And I would really, really like to get involved.
I'll tell you what. Let us come up with a range of investments that we think you might be interested in, and next month, we'll run the whole lot of them by you.
Okay.
Fine. Thank you. All right, gentlemen.
Let's go over this one more time. What is the objective?
The shock and awe.
That was shockingly awful. What is the objective?
Shock and awe.
What is the objective?
Excuse me, sir?
Yes, Albert? Yes, Albert?
I don't really agree with that.
You don't really agree with what?
I think if you want to invest $500,000 in your friend's business, that's exactly what you should do.
Albert!
No, you don't need us to tell you what to do. We're a board of advisors. We're not your kindergarten teachers. And if you want to be taken seriously as an adult, I suggest you start taking yourself seriously as an adult instead of asking for permission to invest your own money from a boardroom full of your daddy's golf buddies.
That's quite enough.
You know what? I'm not finished. I mean, I'd like to see anybody in this room handle the attention and publicity that she's had to deal with her whole life, with half her class. We should be taking advice from you, Miss Cole. Not the other way around.
Sit down, Miss... No, you know what? I quit!
One of my favorite scenes. You can end it now. Thank you. So this is one of my favorite scenes from this movie, and I wanted to share that with you this morning because this is a really accurate depiction of what happens every single day to women when we want to discuss money or when we want to take decisions with our own money. Banking, finance, insurance is a male-dominated industry. And when women want to speak out and when women want to make differences and have opinions, we're viewed and we're seen as emotional or catty or even as a bitch. And that needs to change. The world needs more Albert Brennemans and less boardrooms of men silencing the voices of women. So women like money and we want more of it. But money means to women things like stability, what it means for our future, where are we going to do, you know, with our money and with our space. It means personal freedom, freedom to decide the things that we want to do, freedoms and peace of mind and legacy creation. How are we protecting our children, our parents, our friends? In the scene that we just saw with Maggie, she wanted to invest in her friend's business. $500,000 isn't a lot of money for a female in that particular situation. And she was shunned and said, no, we have a better idea. And she silenced herself. So for the women in the room, how many times have you stayed silent out of fear of judgment or out of fear that you don't know? Because the reality is that women are not taught about money the way that men are taught about money. As women, we're told stories, excuse me, from a very young age that we're bad at math and that we're bad at money, that we're frivolous spenders. The Gina Davis Institute talks about gender in movie and in media, and the women are always seen as the spenders. Another movie scene, one of my favorite movies, Goodfellas, when the Ray Liotta is with his wife and she wants to go shopping and she says, honey, I need some money to go, you know, get some shopping. And he goes, okay, how much money do you want? And she goes, this much. So women are seen as the spenders. We're not depicted in the positive light that we know what we're doing with money. We're told that we're unable to invest, that we shouldn't be paying off our debt, and that our income is secondary in the household. I historically always made more money than my ex-husband, and even to date, to many of the men that I date. So the Equal Credit Opportunity Act was signed into law in 1974. A lot of you may remember that, okay? Maybe you were born in 1974. Thank God I wasn't born during this time. But, you know, women were not allowed to apply for a credit card, open a bank account, or have a mortgage without their husband's or their father's permission, okay? This is so upsetting to me. So women were less likely and essentially out of luck to get any sort of financing unless their husband or a man in their life vouched for them. You know why? Because if they became pregnant, pregnancy was a disability. And if you got pregnant, that meant that your ability to pay your debts was now on hold. So that meant that your husband or your father had to say, well, you know, if she gets knocked up, I'll take care of it. And this 1974, guys, think about it. This was like yesterday. Okay, this is not that long ago. This is less than 45 years ago. Okay, or a little more than 45 years ago. So our mothers, our fathers, our grandparents remember this. And these are the ideas that they are passing on to you, to me, and to our children. Men are taught to invest. Women are taught to save. Men are taught how to invest and make money grow, while women are taught to save money just in case they have to take care of themselves. Okay, why just in case do I have to take care of myself? Men typically use money to keep score. Women use money to take care of others. And I'm not going to dive into products today, but life insurance is a very, very big key for women. Women see life insurance as a gift of love, where men tend to shun away from life insurance because they feel that I'm a man and I'm going to provide for you. You don't need that. Okay, I'm always going to be here. But women think about that safety. We think about that stability that we need. And honey, I love you. And yes, I hope that you're here forever. But what if you're not? Okay? Men are taught to take investment risks. Women are taught to be cautious about investing. And historically, women are more conservative in their investment choices, while men are more risky with their money. Men ask for what they want. Women ask for what they think they deserve. That's sad. Men learn to be effective investors, and women expect others to know more than them. Look at the scene that we just saw. What happened? She didn't say anything. She didn't know. She was shunned. She was afraid. She was ashamed. She was embarrassed. She just assumed that a boardroom full of men were going to know better than what she wanted, when she knew intuitively that her friend's business was a great idea. Okay? And men gravitate towards higher paying jobs, where women gravitate to helping professions. Because women by nature, we nurture. So we look for ways to help others and to find positions and roles where we can be of service. That doesn't mean that we should be paid any less. So society, culture, and media have the power to shape the beliefs about money, about women, when it comes to money. In order for women to truly obtain wealth, she must continue to fight through the static interference that interrupts her growth. Noise in the form of self-limiting beliefs, the social messages that we're only good as nurturers and helpmates, versus the true challenge that we face, which is to be seen as equal. Now, some unfortunate truths, and I hate to be a Debbie Downer here because it's early in the morning, but this is the reality here. Overall, women earn 82 cents for every dollar earned by men. Now, it may not seem like a lot of money to you, because in the reality, it's 20 cents. But as we scale this back and we really start to look at minorities, even broken down further by Latina or African American women, this number drops even less. Why is this a significant impact? Because women take more time off than men. We take time off for maternity leave. We typically tend to be the caretakers in our families, taking care of our parents, taking care of children. So we lose more time, and therefore losing the opportunity to make more money and to save more and to invest more. This status was fascinating to me, this next one, when I heard. And it says, a woman typically reaches her earning peak at age 44, while a man hits his peak at age 55. I don't know about you, but I'm 44, and I'm not at all at my peak earning. I still got way more to go, which is why I stepped into entrepreneurship and into the unlimited abundance of what I can do on my own, because at the end of the day, all bets are on me. Okay, I won't gamble on a slot machine, but if you want to bet on a sure thing, you're looking at your girl right here. A woman's peak earning is $66,700. On average, a man's peak earnings are at $101,000. 42% of women, of mothers, had to reduce their hours to assist for childcare and for their family members, versus 28% of fathers. 27% of mothers had to quit their job to care for their child or family members, compared to just 10% of dads or of men. More than 75% of long-term caregivers are female. 4 out of 10 women say that they've experienced gender discrimination at work. I can't tell you how many times I have been passed up for promotions because I'm not a boy. And literally, that was the only reason. Because I wasn't part of the boys' club. And no matter how many times I tried to get into that club, because I'd say I'm pretty cool. I'm a pretty cool girl. It didn't matter. It didn't matter. I was still passed up for those promotions based on nothing but gender. Men less qualified than me, less experienced than me, less educated than me, and in fact, they made me train them to do my job and continue moving up the ranks. Let's see. Oh, what happened to my slideshow? What did I press? Thank you. Let's see. All right, so less than 70% of women are saving for retirement compared to 81% of men. 40% of men have invested money into the stock market compared to only 22% of women. Women invest 40% less than men if they had extra money. I mean, again, we're kind of spenders by nature. I'm not going to be mad at that. But 35% of men more are likely to invest. Women are twice as likely than as men to associate negative emotions with finance. Women are 5 times more likely to live paycheck to paycheck than men. Women pay 7% more on average for female marketed goods like razors, tampons, shampoo, and more. This is called a pink tax. And it adds up to $82,000 more in expenses in a woman's lifetime. And 60% of women have reported working more than one job to make ends meet versus 32% of men. And I do believe that the reason that women work more and do more is because we're still stuck in a I have to prove myself mentality. I still have to earn my keep, and I have to prove that I am worthy of every dollar and every single thing that I am doing in my profession. So women are working 2 and 3 jobs, we're going to college, we're working out, we're going to the gym, we're looking good, we're taking care of the kids, and men are just, I don't know what y'all are doing. Coming home, you know, they got it easy. So there is some good news, okay? Throughout the global economy, women are starting and running new businesses at a rapid rate. The rising economic clout of women is perhaps one of the most significant economic shifts of recent decades. Gen X and millennial women say that they've earned their wealth through business versus older women, such as the baby boomers, who gains their wealth by inheritance. Baby boomer women would source opportunities to succeed in the workplace as their key to wealth generation, versus the younger generations of women put more emphasis on resources that help them start successful businesses. That's what I do. The gender wage gap is at a standstill, and many women have taken matters into their own hands by starting their own businesses. Between 2014 and 2019, there was a 21% increase in women-owned businesses. So there is a lot of great news and a lot of momentum that we are making, because we're realizing that the only way to truly impact change is to make the change ourselves and to be the change. And if there is no lane, then I will make my lane. And that is what a lot of women are doing today. All right. So women not only own and control more generational wealth than ever before, they're also changing the direction of wealth management and the goals of wealth creation. Millennial women, in particular, are taking a new direction. And while many women still feel some of the familiar gender constraints, particularly as decision makers, the surveys, I'm talking about the ones you saw on the previous slide, suggest that the younger that women are and the more wealth they accumulate, the less that those restrictions will apply. The future that emerges is of high net worth women who routinely start and run businesses and who increasingly direct their own wealth building. The more assets they accumulate, the more they direct their wealth and legacy planning themselves, and the more female influence will be felt throughout our society. All right, and that concludes my presentation. I can definitely talk a little bit more longer on this topic, but I would love to take questions from all of you. I hope all of you have been sipping your coffee, not too hungover for those of you who made it this morning.
And this, go ahead, sorry. Great presentation. Loved it. Thank you. I am actually a big woman empowerment advocate, and our company is a fintech company, so this definitely resonated with me, and I love it. But one of the things that I'm running into when we're talking about finances and being able to, you know, get over to women the importance of it is being able to break the, I guess you would say, the thoughts that they had, and being able to understand that they can do that. Also giving examples. And so it seems like that's the part that's hard to break the pre-programming, I guess is what I'm trying to say. So on this journey of trying to not only let them know that it is okay, you know, do you have any tips or, you know, not just for females, but even male who want to be able to empower the women in their lives to understand finances? Do you have any tips or strategies to be able to use for those women who are just like scared of it or can't break through that past programming?
Yes, absolutely. That is a phenomenal question. So one of the first ways that we can truly start to understand what our relationship is with money is start looking at your childhood and start looking at what those patterns are within your life. For example, what did you learn from your parents? Did you hear you have to work hard for money? Did you hear money doesn't grow on trees? Did you hear, well, money is, you know, easy come and easy go? So those are the first little things that you want to start thinking about and how you explore that relationship with money. Because, for example, if you were taught you have to work hard for money, then you are very likely the type of person who is consistently chasing money, chasing opportunities, and it's not necessarily driving any revenue for you. Because you're hearing the words, right, and it's keywords, multiple streams of revenue, and you have to have multiple streams of income, and you know, you gotta have money coming from here and diversify your portfolio. And you can get caught up in that belief and in that mindset. And really what you're doing is just spinning around like a top, doing all of these things, but you're not mastering one specific line item. So get good and get clear at that one place and then start from there. And I do offer that group coaching. I'm not sure if you heard that in the beginning in the presentation, but I do have a financial literacy for women. And every single month we read a different book and I bring in guest speakers on all topics of finance. And one of the things that I specifically am most passionate about now in my career is helping women unravel that mindset, uncover those limiting beliefs in order for you to really step into that next level where you want to be. So thank you.
Obviously, we need more women in leadership. We need to change this inequality in income, but it's not just that we need more women to step up and not be scared. We need to change things for men as well, for them to not look at us like, oh, I don't like the way she's doing this, because they're so used to women being like, how can I help you? Just checking in, do you need anything? How can we bridge that so that way everyone benefits from elevating women?
I agree. Thank you. Great question. So I strongly believe that that's why God gave me sons, not daughters, because really change starts at home. So for those of you in this room and for those of you watching through the live stream, it really changes with us and changing that vocabulary and what it is that we're teaching, right? As I mentioned in the previous slide, women are taught that they're not good with money, right? Typically in a regular home, if you think back to the way that you grew up, what would happen? Your mom made dinner, you sat down at the dinner table, dad would come home from work, you'd all sit down. Dad would stay with the boys and the sons and talk about work and talk about, you know, I don't know, building stuff and money and investing and whatever, football. And the girls would clear the table and help clean the kitchen. And we have some, you know, great recipes that we know how to make because I'm a phenomenal cook. But dads need to start taking, or uncles or brothers or cousins need to start taking a more active approach in teaching young women about money and about investing. Why is it a secret? Why can't we know about that? Why do you automatically assume that because I like pink and I wear lipstick that I'm not smart enough or I'm not intelligent enough to grasp a conversation? So that is really where the change needs to begin, is at home. Because yes, I'm on a mission to change the world, but I can only change one person at a time. And if the men in the room today and the people watching are shifted and there's any little light bulb that goes off in their head, then my work here is done. So thank you. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things I wanted to say was I feel like with this new generation of millennials, like, they don't seem to be as caught up on, like, sexuality, men being different or better than women, politics, religion, the way that other generations have been. So I am excited for them when they get more into business and politics, all that kind of stuff, that a lot of this crap will, like, kind of go away. Mm-hmm. But I do agree with you. I think that it is, allies are definitely very important. And I also think that it definitely does start in the home. And that's the consistent thing I'm hearing throughout this whole conference. It's like, we're not taught this stuff in school, anything about money management. So all we know is what we know. So if you come from a house like mine, which was like, there'll be more where that came from.
Yes.
You know, then you don't have any idea on how to do any of this stuff, and trying to relearn it as an adult is very tricky. Yeah,
and that's beautiful that you had that experience where there was an abundant mindset in your home where you said, well, there'll be more of that where that came from. Because typically, and for myself, I'm first generation American to immigrant parents. So my parents fled communist Cuba. Well, not my parents, my grandparents. And we had to rebuild here with nothing. So our mindset and what was passed on to me was also very different. So there was a lot of hard work. And my grandfather, you know, may he rest in peace, built one of the largest insurance agencies in Miami, founded in 1977, made it onto Latin Forbes. And that was a beautiful thing. But when he passed, I watched my mom and my aunt struggle because money always was there. And then they didn't know how to duplicate wealth. How do I make money now? And that's something that we need to teach. Anything else? I think I'm officially at zero.
And I'm so excited. We're going to follow this talk with a panel of five gentlemen.
Oh, amazing. I won't boo the boys. I'll be nice. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.